Welcome to the February 2nd, 2016 meeting of the Everett Planning Commission. We'll start with roll call, please.
Chair Holland.
Here.
Commissioner Tisdall.
Here.
Commissioner Adams.
Here.
Commissioner Sand.
Here.
Commissioner Jordison.
Here.
Commissioner Beck.
Here.
Commissioner Zielinski.
Here.
Commissioner Lark.
Here.
Has the commission had an opportunity to review the Planning Commission meeting minutes from January 19th, 2016? And if so, any comments or corrections?
I'd move that we approve the minutes as proposed.
Second.
Commissioner Zielinski.
Abstain.
Commissioner Beck.
Yes.
Commissioner Jordison.
Abstain.
Commissioner Sand.
Yes.
Commissioner Adams.
Yes.
Commissioner Tisdall.
Abstain.
Chair Holland.
Yes. Any reports or anything from the or from committees or anything like that from the Planning Commission members?
I unfortunately learned that it was very hard to find the tree committee meeting room on a really wet Thursday night and that no one in Forest Park compound had any clue where the meeting was either. So anyways, unfortunately I did not attend, but I will attend the next one. So
thank you. Any other items from the commission? Okay. Staff comments?
Yes, thank you, Alan Giffen, Planning Director. A couple of things. First of all, I wanted to acknowledge that Jerry Urban of our staff retired about 10 days ago, and I know some of you had worked with Jerry or knew him, and he had been with the city 40 years, and so in his place we have promoted Steve Inglesby to the Land Use Manager. So typically we don't have a whole lot of business with the Land Use Division coming in front of the Planning Commission, but Steve has been here on code amendments in the past, and now we have another staff member who also left for another job, so we're down a couple of people right now and advertising for the assistant planner position and hoping to fill those two vacancies out of that list that we'll be establishing. On a couple of other items, things that the commission has recently worked on that are going forward to the city council, the slab termination of the development agreement up here on Rockefeller, that will be heard before the city council on the 17th, briefing tomorrow night. The two code amendments that you approved at your last meeting or recommended to the city council will be going for a third and final reading and public hearing on February 24th. Also, the City Council may be taking some action to increase your workload. Tomorrow night they're considering a moratorium ordinance on the addition of any further, any more retail marijuana stores in the city. The current regulations from the state limit it to 5. They're proposing to increase that to allow up to 10 stores in Everett, and the council will be considering at a public hearing tomorrow night whether or not to establish a moratorium, and if they do, then a work program item coming back to the Planning Commission. We've structured it so that it would be in effect for up to a year unless we get done with it sooner than that, but that could be something that'll be coming your way in the not too distant future if council takes action tomorrow night on that. So that's it for my comments. David, did you have anything? Okay.
Thank you. Well, this is an opportunity for anyone in the audience to address the commission on items that are not on the agenda. If you would like to do so, please make sure to fill out a slip there, and you can come to the podium and give your name and address for the record. Seeing none, we have, looks like, three agenda items tonight. And the first agenda item is related to metropolitan planning sub-area, so I'll turn it over to Dave, it looks like.
Yeah, thank you. David Solheim, Long Range Planning Manager. So this is the first time that I get to do something in front of you guys. So quite excited, including trying to figure out how to run PowerPoint here. So First off, long-range planning staff, we've been working on the, this is something that came out of your comprehensive plan update that you did last October. The city council passed as part of the update of the comprehensive plan to relook at the metropolitan planning area. And so planning staff, long-range planning staff, we've been kind of working on putting the work plan together. And so this has been a team effort. Niels is going to lead and be the project manager for this effort, and so he's doing a he's going to be the workhorse on this, and look forward to that. And you folks have met Paul before, and of course you know Karen, so it's going to be a team effort between us and the long range. And then we anticipate, of course, Alan's going to be with us on this, along with other city staff and of course the public. So tonight what we thought we'd do is do a little bit of an overview, kind of step back a little bit, about talk about the metropolitan planning area a little bit, go through the brownfield planning process. Paul's going to cover that, and then Niels is going to go through the draft public participation plan that we provided to you folks and ask for some feedback on that so that we can help get this very interesting process kicked off here. So as you might know, is that we're part of the Puget Sound Regional Council, and there's five metropolitan areas that are actually designated within that area. There's one for every county, but King County gets two. They get Bellevue and Seattle. And so for every county, there's a designated center, and Everett's one of those metropolitan centers within that area. Ooh, a little fast on the draw there. As part of the regional growth strategy, one of the things that they anticipate doing is to increase the percentage of population and employment in the metropolitan areas. And really what that is about is trying to, I think, make more efficient the investment in the transportation networks that we have in the Puget Sound area, including what Alan's gonna talk about in the next agenda item is the ST3 proposal to come to Everett. So in order to do that, to have some significant increases in the percentage of population and employment that are going into the metropolitan center. So when you adopted the plan last fall, you identified the metropolitan center. This does include, it's not the outside boundaries here, but it's the inside. And I think Paul has, I think the next slide we have a little bit better drawing of this, but it's this area, but the outside of that includes some of the residential overlay. But it is a very large metropolitan sub-area plan. It covers a large area, including downtown and Everett Station. So it's actually, from my perspective, kind of coming into this, I think it's a challenging area because I think there are some very distinct areas within this part of the community. And so trying to tie it all together in one sub-area plan is going to be part of our challenge here. So this is a little bit more focus in on this area. And so as a reminder, the number that we're looking at overall in Everett is trying to accommodate another 60,000 people. Did I get that right, Al?
Yes.
Okay, I'm trying to memorize this stuff now. 60,000 people over the next 20 years by 2035, and another 45,000 employees. And a large portion that we'd anticipate to be within the metropolitan area. By the way, one of the things that we had in our staff meeting today is that we're kind of interested in kind of naming this area a little bit different too. For some reason, it just doesn't resonate a little bit with me calling it the metropolitan area. So I want to put that little kernel of thought as you think about public participation, because there's a little bit of branding and thinking about how we envision Everett in the future, and perhaps calling it metropolitan might not be it, but maybe it is. So when I looked at the different goals and stuff like that, these are the things that kind of jumped out to me as being the objectives of this. Is first off is that we have existing plans, and there's nothing that I've heard or seen so far that says that we're really, the vision's wrong or anything. So really part of the process is to either reaffirm or do some adjustment of the visions of the existing plans. So that's part of what we anticipate doing. Second is looking at capital improvements. What kind of investment do we need to really stimulate things to happen within this area, including the light rail to achieve that vision? So light rail is going to have a significant impact. Might not be here for 20 years, but we have to start thinking about where that's going to be and how it fits within that area. I know I saw Chris last night, and I think there was other commission members that were Alex as well, that was at the Housing First Forum last night downtown. And so the issues of the Community Streets Initiative is going to be something that within this area is clearly going to be something that we need to try to weave within this conversation of the sub-area. Paul's going to talk about the brownfield redevelopment, and part of the project there is to look at catalyst sites for redevelopment. So what are some of the brownfield sites within the community? It could be catalyst sites that look at redevelopment. Those could be either public sites or private sites as part of that. And finally, the last thing is kind of create that implementation strategy to achieve the vision. So with that, I'll ask Paul to come up and kind of cover his thing on the brownfield. And again, then we'll come back to the public participation strategy, and I ask for some stuff there. Thanks. How do you move this forward? Either the wheel.
Quick question here.
We talked about this last June or July. I just joined the city in June, so I've learned a lot since that time. What I'd like to do tonight is give you a just a little bit of history and an update on what we've been doing and the kind of projects we have underway and where this is all going to lead us. Come here. There. Low tech. Just a quick overview. We started this in the fall of 2013 with our EPA grant. It's $400,000, and we have used a little over two-thirds of that, so we're right on track with our total of $400,000 for all the work that's been done. There's a consulting team that has been carrying the brunt of the work, Stantec, large engineering planning firm, Makers, whom I think you're familiar with, and Leland out of Portland, they're economic and market consultants that are helping us trying to make sense out of all this information. You've seen this before, I think, but the question is always good to bring back of why we're doing this, spending all this time and all this money. Really, it's pretty straightforward. We're trying to, I guess, set the stage, create some opportunities for redevelopment through this process where we can identify sites, identify brownfields, first of all, then identify sites and figure out how to deal with those sites and get that redevelopment activity going. We have quite a variety of kinds and locations of brownfield sites, but we also have a lot of different opportunities for different kinds of development. And, of course, what we get out of this eventually is a just general sense of revitalization. I mean, bringing people, bringing residents, bringing employees, and perhaps some new open space or park space as a part of this redevelopment process, improving the city, increasing the value of properties and the neighborhoods. And of course, it's all about the dollar too. I mean, we're creating jobs, we're creating revenue. Makes for a much more stable. And in an ideal world, this is going to bring everything to us. The scope of work that we're doing with this, we have, five or six points in this three-year process, or the overall management of the grant, working with EPA on the basic administration of it. We've done quite a bit of outreach the last couple of years. A lot of that was done before I came, and the consultants with the staff, as you recall, went through this inventory process and to identify and focus down on those sites, and we are now actively working on environmental site assessments, which I can talk a little bit more about in just a minute, which will lead to cleanup plans, redevelopment plans for specific properties, some of those catalyst sites that we think if we can line up the property owner and the market and the opportunity to redevelop certain properties that will trigger additional work, that's what we're looking for. And the grant, EPA calls these planning areas, like Metro Center, area-wide plans. We've taken that and basically folded that right into our sub-area process. We originally started out thinking about two sub-area plans, or two area-wide plans, if you may. And what we did was we combined our funding and our efforts into an expanded Metro Center with the downtown and the original Metro Center area, so that we can concentrate on one large-scale, really relevant plan. The college district that we had thought about is simply moved down the calendar a little ways. But we think we can take full advantage of this grant and just seamlessly carry it right through it into our sub-area process. It's going to save us a lot of work and give us a good product to really carry that sub-area to completion. So a little quick history. We started out with an inventory of the entire city, hundreds and hundreds of potential brownfield sites, and then began working down the funnel to somehow try and narrow the focus and decide where we want to direct our efforts. We came up with target areas scattered around the city, areas that had more of a concentration of brownfield sites and maybe some good chances for redevelopment and some good benefit from the process. From there, we kept coming down and ended up with these three focus areas. The slide on the left, north is it's this way, to my right, with Broadway coming up through the middle. The center slide is the original Metro Center, centered around the Everett Station and so forth, and then the riverfront area. We were going to focus on College and Metro Center, and like I said, we've really come down now to truly focus on the center part of the city. But for each of those areas, each of those three, the consultants put together this massive inventory of detail for every potential brownfield parcel. Just an incredible amount of information, and I call it a cut sheet for every single brownfield property in addition to that spreadsheet list. So lots of information to work with, lots of data. And from that, we began the process of defining which sites could be considered for cleanup, for environmental assessment. Interested owners, the right kinds of locations, or the right kinds of possibilities. But this past year, since 2016, We've had a few presentations with you last summer with the Brownfield Advisory Committee. We've had two meetings last year. I'm sorry, a meeting last year. We also met with that group just a few weeks ago, just last month, to bring them up to date. And we also presented this whole process at a state conference back in October or September. Done a lot of property owner interviews. Both staff and the consultant, Leland Consultants, a number of interviews to try and define just what they were looking for and how we could move their properties into the closer to redevelopment. Trying to scope out this. We spent a lot of time scoping out this work for this sub-area plan / area-wide plan. It takes quite a bit of time to really nail down that process. And we're working on more nominations for sites. And doing site assessments. At this point, we're really focused on site assessments. We've used up most of the dollars we have toward finding and beginning to assess these sites, and we're moving into the last third of that whole process. So we're doing, I should know this, I want to say 7 or 8 phase one assessments, which is basically a records review, in-depth records review, property inspection, a lot of paperwork. There's no physical on-site activity. It's trying to define past uses, adjacent owners, where the potential contamination is or where it's coming from, which may or may not lead to a phase two. And we're going to be doing probably 5 or 6 phase two assessments, which is actual like sampling and testing of the site to determine just exactly what is in this property and what's the extent of it and how bad is it? You know, what's it going to take to try and remediate it? So I'm going to just touch real quickly on several that we have underway. But those red rectangles are the ones we now have either in process, completed, or in the process with EPA for approval of doing a site assessment. A couple of them up north, a number of them that are in the Metro Center area, the downtown, and a couple on, further toward the east. A pretty good variety, and I'll show you what we're up to. One of the ones, this one is, the phase one is complete, and will not lead to a phase two assessment based on what they've discovered so far. But they are planning to expand or build 75 to 100 affordable housing units on these between these two parcels here. Their office now is
right here, in the corner.
That's at Broadway and 34th, something like that. A Cocoon House, which is right behind Group Health, is looking to demolish the building that was built actually as a motel back in the 1980. It was the late 70s, and rebuild on the spot and perhaps try and get some land from Denny's restaurant to the south. We haven't started that one yet, but we'll be starting that very, very, very soon. 1111 Hewitt is the corner of Hewitt and I want to say Marine View. It's a Prax Air, I think, business right now. We have several right in the downtown area that are good targets for assessing to see what the obstacles are and thinking about, you know, is this a corner that could be potentially a catalyst site? The corner at Hewitt and Bond, Hewitt to the north, is an old gas station. Some of you may remember this, and you may remember the airplane when it sat on top of the building. I'm not sure when that airplane came down or when the building came down, but I know the property's been vacant for at least 25 years. It's been some time. And there is some contamination there. We've started a phase one assessment on this. May well lead to a phase two. 3011 Grand. It's another, I'll say this is a 3011 Grand. Is this the auto repair? Oh, well, look at the picture. Former business in here. I'm not sure if there's a business in there now or not, but this is a, you know, a small single site that might be a good candidate for redevelopment. We're applying for a phase one assessment on that. On Rucker, this is the auto repair on the corner that would also be, I think, a good candidate for redevelopment. And there are some problems there. They have a long history of auto repair. And the effort now is we've applied for approval on assessments to find out just how bad it is. And it may not be as bad as we think, but there's likely to be quite a bit of contamination. Those all fall within what we're calling the Metropolitan Center, but then just beyond, there's just a couple more, just beyond the northern boundary up on 25th and Wetmore. You went through this past fall with the Williams to redesignate the land use for multifamily. They've got an application in that they went through a pre-application, so it's an active project, and we are going to be doing a phase one on that property. There used to be, I guess, for a number of years, auto repair across the alley from this property, so there's some likely contamination there. And further north, on 12th and Broadway, it's the buildings have been demolished right on the Broadway frontage. With the old trailer park behind, that could potentially jump right to a phase two site assessment because they have done some work in the past. I think this is the last one. Baker Heights is the big one. It's the first one we actually started. The phase one assessment is now complete. And the Everett Housing Authority is now, we're working with them to apply for a Choice Neighborhoods grant from HUD, which will really initiate work if they land the grant in a much larger area which will eventually, I think we can use that as a, in the similar subarea process. It's about 15 acres. They did a phase one, didn't really find any significant contamination, asbestos and lead in the buildings, but site-wise, it's pretty clean. As far as next steps, obviously we're pushing forward with this Metro Center process. It's the big project we have now. We're still doing some, they're called eligibility determinations. It's a, basically an application EPA that says, here's this property, here's why we need to assess this, and here's what it could lead to. We're in the process for a couple of things like that. Actively involved in our assessments, which will eventually, as a part of this grant-related subarea plan, will lead to some remediation plans and redevelopment plans for specific property. You know, we'll really focus in on those catalyst sites. Oops, I meant to delete the second Metro Center subarea out of there. But the grant does end of September, so we don't have a lot of time. But we'll finish up this I'll call it the first phase of the subarea, the grant-funded portion, by end of August. And we'll be back several times with that process as we go through it. And then I'm hoping that late this year we can start applying for some actual cleanup dollars. There's a whole series of EPA grants that will become eligible for after going through this inventory process. That brings you up to speed in a short way. Can I take any questions at this point, or shall we carry on?
Paul, has there been any discussion about how you will prioritize these sites when you make application for the funding, cleanup funding? Because I imagine that if I'm a property owner and I have one of these sites, it would be very much to my advantage to have federal or state or whatever kind of money come in and do the cleanup, as opposed to me being responsible for that myself. So how do you go about prioritizing who will?
It's going to depend on a few variables, things like the location. Actually, the ones that we have put through the process or are in the process with are all potentially eligible for future funding. But what we're going to be looking for is the right locations and a willing cooperative property owner who will directly gain some benefit, some fairly immediate benefit from cleanup work. And depending on how much money we have, if we get some grant money, that'll determine how far we can spread those dollars. But we're going to be trying to find, once we've compiled all these site assessments, which ones are the ones that may be most suitable, best suited in a number of ways to carry on to the next step. And in my mind, it's properties that are in the right location that the market supports some kind of redevelopment, and the owner is willing to engage in that with that attitude of let's get something done.
Any other questions of Paul?
Are you finding any of the owners are helping with these site assessments? They're pretty expensive. Not a level one, but a level two.
Actually, I am discussing with a couple of the owners that we haven't gotten approval from EPA yet for about chiming in on the cost of the assessments, because we are coming up. We have more sites now than we have grant money remaining to do, so we're going to be looking for a little extra support on that, especially with the private for-profit owners out there. So the short answer is yes, we are going to be looking for some contribution, some help toward the process.
And the response, it seems like it's been very good in terms of, it's almost like a target you're putting on a piece of private property. This is, you know, a brownfield. But it seems like the owners are positively responding to the opportunity.
They are. We have more than we can do, and there's another possibility of applying for, in talking with the consultant, applying for additional funding for the same type of work we've just done. We have the inventory, solid inventory, but we may be able to garner some more funding with the success of this effort to do some more assessments and fan out to some other properties. And I think as this, we've been trying to, you know, convey the message for several months about, I've got some free help here for you, property owner. No responsibility the EPA is not going to come to you looking for you to clean up your property once you do
the
this.
Liability.
It's simply a step to figure out what you've got. So, yeah, there's a lot of interest out there.
Good.
Are local matches required of these with these cleanup grants?
That I don't know. I don't think so, but I can't say for sure for the cleanup grants.
Because if there are, that might be one way of sort of winnowing the field.
I'm sorry?
I say that might be a way of narrowing down who actually
applies. Yes.
Because who's willing to step up and meet the local match if there is a local match.
Right. When we first started with our first project was the Baker Heights and Everett Housing Authority, and they in the beginning were willing to say pay up to about half of the cost of the assessment. And then we were able to work things out where we fully covered their costs with the grant, and being a nonprofit. And we've got, three nonprofits in this group of properties, which are really ideal candidates since they do truly have very limited resources. But, that's a good point.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's see.
Good evening, Neil Stegos from Planning Staff. Tonight I'll be discussing with you the draft public participation plan that we've put together. And for currently for lack of a better term, I'll say Metropolitan Center or Metro Center interchangeably for tonight's discussion. But looking at the Metropolitan Center plan, since public involvement is an integral part to this, since it'll be written for and with guidance by the public, we really felt that a public participation plan was in order here. We also intended to see this as a living document that will be amended as needed from input from the public and through the process. On the map, on the first page is a very simplified map that shows the various planning processes and plans that the city has gone through in the recent past, starting in 2005, where we had the Everett Station Subarea Plan. And then in 2006, we went through the downtown plan. 2008, we adopted the Broadway Mixed Use Zone, along with the core residential. And then in 2009, we have the downtown Everett Streetscape Plan. The plan itself is comprised of various components, the first being the identification of the public participation goal. We also wanted to identify community stakeholders and interested citizens, along with devising an approach and a schedule for the effective public participation, and then lastly, identifying the roles and responsibilities. When looking at this public participation plan, we really wanted to craft something that was simple enough to convey so that the public would, one, be engaged and want to stay engaged throughout the process. So we tried to limit a lot of planning's jargon and keep it engaging. So with that, the goal we narrowed down to, or we tried to craft to, one simple goal, and that is to make the planning process for the Metropolitan Center plan accessible, inclusive, and engaging to stakeholders and all members of the public. on page 3, we've identified up to this point what we see as the stakeholder list, and we divide it up into categories: members of the public, business community, various environmental stakeholders, city officials, city departments, other local government, public transit being a key component to this, tribes, state government, federal government, social service agencies, and then our all-inclusive other. The approaches to strategies for engaging the public, we have listed on pages 4 and 5. We've listed a stakeholder list. That list, through time, can be amended and updated. The Planning Commission, work sessions, hearing, city councils, work sessions, city advisory boards and commissions. We will be drafting an online survey that the community can take part of, as well as a hard copy. We'll be utilizing our webpage and various social media that we have access to, press releases, public gatherings, and eventually an open house. The schedule and opportunities for public participation. As Paul mentioned, we are under a fairly tight timeline with the grant ending in September. We're thinking that this entire entire process for the subarea plan may take roughly about a year. So we're thinking at this point that it should be wrapped up by February or March of 2017, potentially.
I'd like to just, Alan Giffen, add that that's an ambitious goal. In our best efforts, if we could get done that quickly, that would be wonderful. But I've been through enough of these to say that they oftentimes do get slowed down, or just the volume of public participation kind of dictates that you have to slow down or take a more detailed look at a variety of things. But our best efforts, we would be done in about a year.
There's a reference to Appendix A. Is that the project timeline and the 4 phases?
No, we're currently drafting Appendix A. So Appendix A is a more detailed breakdown of that, but the project timeline encapsulates the scope of the appendix.
I noticed that there was a reference to the Planning Commission reviewing the draft plan chapter by chapter by chapter, which seems like a sequence of discussion workshops and then public input to the Planning Commission. And that's how I wondered. I looked at this timeline, Al, and I just says, there's just no way it can happen. I mean, it's going to take a huge, huge effort. And the question would be, what's really driving the schedule?
And we don't have any deadlines where we're having to complete something by a given time frame. And so this is a very optimistic schedule. I think that we will find, because it's larger than the area that we used for the downtown plan, that took us about a year. For the Everett Station area plan, when we did that one back in about, well, it started in the early 2000s and didn't wrap it up until about 2005, that we're revisiting a lot of existing policies, visions, and development standards, things of that nature, that by having a good base of fairly recent planning efforts with the 4 different processes Neil mentioned between the core residential area, Broadway, downtown, and Everett Station, we can re-examine some of those things. They're not totally starting from scratch, and see if there are additional things that we need to add to that. For example, the streets initiative related type issues. And some of those I could see really dragging this out a bit farther, but that was an optimistic schedule that we put down here, and I wanted to caveat that before we got too far into it, that we're not held by any deadlines, but obviously we want to make good progress in a timely fashion.
I think it's always good to have a really tight schedule, an aggressive schedule for consultants and staff. But then when you're talking to the public, I think we need to be a little bit more generous with the time, so there isn't a perception that we're not completing our work in a timely fashion. And just recognize that the public process needs to be very deliberate and inclusive, so.
Right. Thank you.
Okay.
Just have a question. I noticed that we have some groups listed as members of the public and stakeholders that are outside the city of Everett, like the tribes. And I'm just curious, would we not, and it says other local government, and we have Snohomish County listed here. I notice we don't have any of our neighboring jurisdictions. And I just wonder if perhaps we shouldn't at least offer to engage, say, the city of Marysville or the city of Mukilteo or the city of Snohomish. I don't want to overcomplicate it, but you know, it seems that we are, if we're attempting to be regional, we should at least maybe reach out and you know, inquire as to. Now, I don't know what the all the little ramifications of that might be, but you know, do you have any comment on that?
Thank you. And just to say that in our staff meeting today, we did discuss branching it out to local jurisdictions, and that's actually spelled out in a checklist that the PSRC did for regional centers. So we will be. And we can add that, amend that stakeholder list to indicate that. But just to finish up, talking or wrapping up the discussion on the public participation plan. We crafted seen it as four different phases, the first being an initial outreach and assessment that could last up and through June, relooking the visions and goals of the various sub-area plans and planning processes that we've had, and introducing the stakeholders to the process, and then potentially in summer, culminating with the final reports that we get from our consultants, drafting the first draft of the Metropolitan Center plan itself, and then later finalizing the Metropolitan Center, and then finally going through the legislative process and adopting the Metro Center plan. So,
Mr. Chair,
yes, sir.
Got a question. On the project timeline in the four phases, the first one is initial outreach and assessment, and it says winter 2016. I kind of assumed that was winter 2015. And so has that part been completed already?
For winter 2016 in the timeline, we're thinking that's January through the vernal equinox, so
oh, okay.
March
okay.
21st.
Okay.
First.
So we really haven't started yet.
Not the public outreach part of it, no.
Okay.
Other than brownfield.
That's correct.
Any other questions for Niels? Thank you. Well, I guess this is an opportunity for the public to address the commission on agenda item number one tonight. Is there anyone who'd like to address the commission? Seeing none, just want to turn it back over to staff.
I guess what we're looking for is just any general feedback that you have about the planning process, and particularly the public participation side of that.
Go ahead.
I like to watch the community channels. Bad habit. But I didn't notice that was on here. I didn't know if there was a plan to use some video of meetings to have them posted on the, or shown on the community channel.
Good suggestion.
Yeah. Yeah, we had talked about that, but didn't include that, so that's a good one. Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Are you getting consulting help with public participation in terms of the survey and the webpage or information distribution?
We're getting consultant help through the brownfield stuff, so most of the work that Paul referred to, the remaining tasks is Makers is going to be doing a lot of the planning work for that, so a lot of that money that's left in their planning firm. I don't think we're going to have them work on the survey stuff. They'll probably be internal work. So, and again, it's kind of the nice thing about the college neighborhood process slowing down is that it allows the long-range planning staff for us to focus in on this. And so that's kind of our project, and so we'll be doing a lot of those tasks that might otherwise be assigned to consultants.
Okay. And the reason I'm asking, because I would see having digital media as being extremely important at this juncture in terms of communication and, you know, and getting the word out and having people participate.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm speaking personally. I commute, and that's 10 hours of my day gone. So to make it to neighborhood meetings is challenging for a lot of folks. So I just would encourage that there's a really good plan for how you're going to do digital media and solicit input into the process.
Yeah, in fact, we're looking at a product that's kind of assessing, and we're going to bring in the communication staff and the neighborhood staff. And again, it's not only the long-range planning group, but it's going to be the city. We're trying to pull all the departments in, including the communications people, and developing those strategies for that. And so Neil's mentioned the social media, other things. There's different ways to push out that product through websites and other broadcasts that we're going to try to find those avenues to do this. So hopefully I'm trying to draft some things to get some interns to come in to potentially to help with some of that public participation as well. So
a couple months ago, I had the opportunity to hear a discussion about the use of social media down in King County in Seattle, and they've been extremely successful in using that as a vehicle to get the information out and participation. So it might be worthwhile to have a call down there and talk to those folks as to how they've been putting that together, but
yeah,
extremely helpful in their process.
Right.
And if you digitize that survey, that's a database being made in process.
Yeah.
And you can cull that. Yeah. There's all sorts of algorithms that you can get amazing information, from that database.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, we're looking at all those different aspects of doing things. And one of the things that it's mentioned in here too, but we didn't get into the details, but to going to other places as well, you know, is us other events that are happening, and we'll just jump in on their party and, put our things into there. We had some outreach things we've done in other communities where, you know, go to the farmer's market and do a table, you know, things like that. So, you know, again, where are people gathering in different places? Are people gathering and they're going to Everett Station? You know, they're hopping on the train. Is there ways for us to engage the public in other places type of thing? Rather than them come to us, we can go to them, and so find ways to do that. So any of those different places to do that, you know, as you think about those, let us know so that we can think about trying to incorporate that into our efforts.
Mr. Sand.
So we recently had a conversation about the why and them moving out of town. And then we saw in the newspaper discussions about Trinity College moving out. So in this whole process, will there be a fair amount of discussion about what can be done to try and keep some of these anchor activities within the downtown area, or what can be done to make the downtown more attractive for some anchor activities? I mean, I'm assuming that this it'd be beneficial for the city to have more than just apartments downtown. And I know a number of years ago there was discussion of the county potentially moving county offices out of town, which I think would just destroy everything. So will there be a discussion here about economic development, what can be done to promote and preserve those folks that we have downtown right now?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's, you know, this is the metro area. It's downtown Everett Station. It's kind of the hub of the city. So, you know, to do a planning effort without having that discussion would be missing a big hole. So absolutely anticipate doing that.
So who will be the experts that will help us with that?
There's quite a few. So one of the things that we did internally this morning, and I haven't had a chance to share this with Alan yet, so I get to share it with Alan and you together. But we kind of talked about staff this morning about, you know, the role of the project manager of Neil's. But again, this is a team effort, and so we've taken all those subjects between the four of us, and we're all assigned those different things kind of to help Neil. So it's not all on Neil's shoulder. So different folks will be doing these things, and I think that Karen signed up for economic development, if I'm not mistaken. Paul and Niels are doing historic preservation, and Niels is doing design. I'm going to work on some housing, transportation issues, things like that. So all of us are going to take some areas and kind of roll with that, and then dump the big stack of paper on Niels and say, write a plan. Just kidding.
I noticed part of the list of folks to be involved would be the financial institutions, and I think conversations with those senior managers or bank presidents, whatever, of the local banks, it'd be really interesting if they would share with you why they're located where they are, and if they were to locate again or go through that thought process, would they still be willing to stay in downtown Everett? Mm-hmm. I mean, what's the value to them to be downtown? And then, of course, you've got folks like the Scottdale family that's building stuff all over the place. Well, they must have some really good insights as to what's been attractive about the development so far and what might be attractive in the future. So I would hope there'd be some workshops with those kind of folks that we could learn from them.
And we do have one of our consultants with the Brownfield program is an economic consultant, Leland and Associates. And so some of their work will lead into the economic analysis and some of the questions that you've asked. We'll have conversations with people like the Economic Alliance and some of the downtown stakeholders, like you mentioned, different businesses.
The port's done a fair amount of looking at the economic development question, too, in terms of their waterfront. And I don't know how much they're sharing that information, but I'm sure it's there.
Yeah.
But that they're also, a resource, probably.
Right.
Well, yeah. But my concern is right downtown. I remember what it used to be like, and it's not that way anymore. It's not so much a downtown anymore, I don't think. So how do we recapture that and not have further anchors kind of moving out someplace else because it's cheaper or easier or parking's better or whatever, for whatever reason they're moving out?
I think it might be worthwhile, if you haven't done so already, to touch base with some of the other metropolitan centers around the region, too, mm-hmm. just to see what they're up to with their planning efforts or what they've done in the past. Besides King County and their use of social media.
You think about what's happening with different, smaller communities. They've all got these town centers now. Mm-hmm. Well, that's downtown. Mm-hmm. That's kind of like a downtown. So, I mean, how do you make that happen?
And probably the most comparable metropolitan center for us would be Tacoma. And they've been doing a lot of work. They face a lot of the same problems. They're a little bit larger, obviously, but they've had some real successes in, for example, the branch campus, University of Washington. That was a major economic development stimulus for Tacoma. But they still are having a lot of the same challenges that we are, despite some of those major regional investments like the light rail and so forth. So, we'll talk with some of them. That's a great idea, Mike.
Spokane might be good too, Alan.
Thank you.
Any other comments from the commission? Okay, looks like we're on to item two, Sound Transit 3.
Okay, Alan Giffen, Planning Director. I wanted to Talk about Sound Transit 3 and particularly focus on Everett, how it might serve and benefit Everett and some of the communications we've been having with Sound Transit staff as they have been developing their plan in preparation for putting a ballot measure before the voters later this year. But for a little history first, talk a little bit about what Sound Transit is and what they have done. It was initially the first ballot measure that was successful was in 1996. That established their platform of services, including light rail, including commuter rail on the existing Burlington Northern lines, and a substantial amount of regional bus service as part of the overall regional transit plan. But light rail was the most significant change in that plan, in that it would build for the first time a high-capacity light rail transit system, the spine of which was going to run from Tacoma on the south to Everett on the north to from Seattle to Redmond on the east. And so with the funding packages that they were able to put together in the first ballot measure in 96, they had light rail that would run between SeaTac Airport and Northgate. And so it's already been completed to SeaTac. It's under construction to Northgate. And they've established the commuter rail along the shoreline here in Snohomish County and from Tacoma up through the Kent Valley into Seattle coming from the south. A lot of regional bus service all over the three-county region, and a number of other supportive capital investments such as the transit centers, park and ride lots, access improvements, and things of that nature. Park and ride lot, for example, at I-5 and 112th in the center of the freeway there is the biggest one in Everett. In 2008, the voters approved Sound Transit 2 that would add additional express bus service on their busiest routes, new sounder routes on the existing lines, and extended light rail from Northgate up to Linwood within Snohomish County and south of SeaTac Airport. I don't recall exactly how far it's going on the south. I don't pay as much attention to what's going on south of Seattle as what we're looking at up here. And it would also run east to the Overlake area, not quite to the end of the line in the east side of King County. So for the proposed Sound Transit 3 package, and they're planning a ballot measure in November of this year, it would complete the spine from Tacoma to Everett for the light rail line and out all the way to Redmond, heading east from Seattle. It would add additional bus rapid transit routes throughout the region and potentially some more light rail extensions. For example, West Seattle and Ballard are under discussion at Sound Transit right now. And there would be a lot of other transit-related improvements, again, such as access improvements to go along with the investments. Light rail stations, obviously, you'll need with the light rail line. In 2014, the Sound Transit Board updated their long-range plan, and I've highlighted with two arrows the items that will relate most directly to Everett. One of those, it's called Project 2 on this map, would extend light rail from downtown Everett up to the north end of Everett in the vicinity of the colleges, approximately around 10th and Broadway. And item six here is a line that would, instead of following I-5, which has always been kind of the concept in previous versions of the long-range plan, would take it out to Payne Field and Boeing Southwest Everett area before coming back toward town into Everett. And so those were added to the plan in 2014. Sound Transit is currently looking at three alternatives for the light rail alignment for Snohomish County, extending it from Linwood to Everett. And on this map, it's similar to the one that I placed on the dais for you. It shows the three alignments in the column 2A, 2B, and 2C. 2A would be this darker blue line that comes up I-5 from Linwood to about 128th, and then would turn west at 128th Airport Road up to the Payne Field Boeing area, come back, at least as conceived by Sound Transit, along 526 up to Evergreen Way, and then back into the north end of the city, or the downtown area, and they show two different options for each of 2A and 2B. And over on the right-hand side here, you can see what those two options are. One would be to turn east on 41st Street, go down to the I-5 right-of-way, and then up Smith Avenue to Everett Station. The other one would have the alignment extending further north on Rucker Avenue up to Pacific Avenue, then coming back over and heading south from Pacific Avenue to Everett Station. And so those would apply to both option 2A and 2B. 2B would follow I-5 from Linwood again up to 128th, take that same turn toward the west up Airport Road until Evergreen Way, and then come in Evergreen Way all the way up to the downtown area, and with both of those options that I just discussed a moment ago. The third option is one that follows I-5 entirely from Linwood up to the Everett Station area along the I-5 right-of-way. And so the city staff and mayor and council member Paul Roberts, who's on the Sound Transit Board, have been meeting and discussing what our recommendations would be on these alignments. And this is fairly similar to a map that is in the comprehensive plan that you've seen before, although if you'll recall that map that we had in the comprehensive plan between 526 at Evergreen Way and about 41st Street, we had a kind of a conceptual line said that alignment needs to be determined. In recent work with Sound Transit, field work that we did with the Sound Transit and their consultants and city staff, we took a look around all of these options between basically Airport Road and downtown, and looked at where stations could be located or should be located. And I'll back up a step here to the preceding slide, and you can see on the map that at least the version that goes out toward Boeing and Payne Field, there's a station at 128th, there's a station at Airport Road and Evergreen Way, a station about 100th Street next to Payne Field. One that is, on this scale of the map, it's hard to see exactly where it is, but it would be south of the Boeing plant at, around Casino, east of Airport Road. Another station in the vicinity of SR 526 and Evergreen Way. And we looked at these different options, and some were eliminated, even some options that aren't even shown on this map. We looked at things like using the interurban right-of-way. We looked at things like using Casino Road or even coming up Seaway Boulevard, going across 75th Street, Severs Ducey, across Madison. And for a number of reasons, those created a lot more impacts and increased the cost. And if there's one thing that I can say about Sound Transit, at this point they're being extremely diligent about driving the cost of these options down. The first versions of all of these were shown to be elevated systems for almost their entire length. But where they can bring them down to surface, they are cheaper. Where they can eliminate a station, obviously, that's going to save some capital and ongoing operational costs. And so what we came up with in discussing with Sound Transit staff and their consultant team is an alignment that, for the city's priority, would still follow Airport Road up to Boeing out 526. And then instead of using the interurban or Evergreen Way, and if you'll recall, when we were doing the Evergreen Way plan, we had the business community telling us that they preferred not to have the light rail on Evergreen Way. That's one of the reasons that the city's position has been to avoid Evergreen Way, but would be then to take it from 526 at Evergreen Way, follow 520, six to the east, and then using either I-5 or South Broadway, whichever works best in terms of cost or reduces the impacts on the residential neighborhoods, coming north into Everett, toward Everett Station. And so I'll show you another drawing in a moment, but our thought was rather than coming up Rucker, looping through downtown, and then heading south toward Everett Station, we still have an idea that that North Everett Station up at the colleges is something we'd like to see at some point, whether it happens now or in a future phase of Sound Transit, we'll have to see. But we didn't want to have the light rail system kind of pointing south and then having to somehow make a maneuver to turn around and go back north. We felt it would be cheaper to run an alignment up South Broadway to Broadway and put the light rail station not only at Everett Station, but actually probably in between Everett Station and Broadway, so that it had better opportunity to serve the downtown and get people across Broadway rather than having to, say, put it south of Everett Station, where you have a much greater distance to get people from the light rail system up to the downtown area. And so Sound Transit, we sent them the letter from the mayor that's in your packet with a whole lot of comments and points and the recommended alignment. They responded with this version of a draft refinement of that plan. And one of the things that they've done is brought this down to grade at a lot of locations. And there's a handout that I've put on the dais in front of you there that has some of this, the Everett part of this. But they've eliminated a station in Linwood. They've eliminated several stations along the airport road alignment and brought the system down to grade to try to reduce costs. But they did reflect the recommendation that we made and drove with them to put the alignment either on, it looks like mostly on I-5 and coming north on Broadway rather than sticking to I-5 and then putting it south of the Everett Station. And these are concept locations at this point. They're going to require a lot more analysis, and this is still at a very gross scale. It's not something where you could pinpoint and say which intersection you would put a station on at, say, Broadway or Pacific or exactly where that would be. It might even be McDougal, but this is kind of the concept alignment that they have responded to us with, showing, at least in this draft, that is one of the considerations for the alignment that would serve Payne Field. And so we're not sure exactly what they will do with this. They're not sure exactly what they're going to do with it yet in our conversations with them, other than do a bit more analysis just in terms of things like estimated ridership and construction costs, O&M costs. But one thing that I want to talk about briefly is that the station that previously had been in this location just south of Boeing, they have proposed eliminating that one and the one at Payne Field and kind of splitting the difference and putting it in the vicinity of the south entrance at Boeing across from Cache Park entrance off of Airport Road. And we were trying to figure out if that's better for Boeing than the location where it was previously or not. But at this location, it's right next to Boeing, and Boeing has an internal transportation system. It's 1,000 acres. It's not exactly a walkable neighborhood where you get off and you can easily walk to your job. And so they do shuttle employees once they get onto the Boeing site to the various job sites within Boeing. And so this might be a good location. We've got inquiries into Boeing. We haven't heard back from them yet to see if one or the other is a better location than the other. So we're still waiting to hear from Boeing on that. So with that, those are kind of the status of the alignments. It's our understanding that they will be, Sound Transit will be presenting this information to their board to refine the plan that we put before the voters in November. Talk just a little bit about the revenue sources that are authorized under state law, and this is right off of the Sound Transit website. Property tax, a sales tax, and a motor vehicle excise tax that would be in addition to those that are already being collected. And so the amount of money that would be raised depends upon whether they run this for a 15, 20, or 25-year time frame. Under, and this again is off of their website, if they ran it for 15 years, it would raise about $15 billion in taxes with other sources of revenue, such as grants, bonds, fares, and other miscellaneous revenues. A 15-year package could provide up to $26 billion in capital. A 20-year program could raise about $30 billion, and a 25-year program could raise up to $48 billion. We haven't seen exactly what all of those options will buy in terms of improvements to Everett. We're thinking that with, for example, a 25-year option, you could probably get the light rail up to the north end of the city. And so those are some things that the Board of Directors for Sound Transit will have to evaluate to determine what the voters' appetite is for a 25-year taxing system as opposed to 15 or 20 years and the projects that come with them. It seems as though everybody who has been testifying or providing comments to Sound Transit wants more Sound Transit, more extensions of light rail, so for example to West Seattle or to Ballard, and not less, but then those are the people that are advocating for the extensions, and I'm sure that's not the entire, representative of the entire Sound Transit District electorate, so they'll do some polling to try and determine what people have an appetite for before they put something on the ballot. So the schedule will be this spring. They will determine, and I think it's March, they'll have, well, they'll be talking about it more in February and March, but I think it's April when they're actually going to decide what to put on the ballot. And so funding options would be certainly one of the key items to determine what they can afford to build. And so the Sound Transit website has a lot of good information. That's just kind of a flavor of the discussions that we've had with them and the city's position on what we think the light rail should be, how it should be developed to serve our growth interests and our development needs, and rather than some of the other alternatives that, for example, the I-5 alignment we didn't think was really very, very good for Everett. It was great for people that live maybe to the north and the east of Everett outside of the Sound Transit District. They can come park their car in Everett and catch a train to their job in Seattle. But that doesn't do a whole lot if they're not putting light rail stations that serve some of our growth needs and interests and support the 60,000 population growth and 45,000 job growth that we're looking at for targets in the next 20 years. So with that, I'll pause and see if you have any questions for me.
Mr. Sand?
I think this is great. I had really serious concerns about having a map that showed dashed lines and different options that really weren't very realistic. But coming up with this proposal and having discussions with Sound Transit that shows a viable option to go out to the Boeing complex and then come back into downtown Everett, I think is really, really important and a huge step if they will make this a part of the system plan so it can be considered as a part of the discussion. But I agree with the concern about dropping out some of these station locations. I think if the city can keep pushing them and show the reasons for having these multiple stations in there, it's much better to have them on the plan now than to let them fall away too early. And I know there's been some discussion as to, you know, what these stations really have to be. I mean, they don't have to be these big, monstrous concrete things out there. They can be something a lot simpler that are used in other locations. So maybe it's just a concept of what the station is that would help with the argument. But I think this is great work by the city to put forward a proposal that makes a whole lot of sense.
Thank you. And we're really happy with the responsiveness that Sound Transit has shown with talking to us and actually incorporating our suggestions into that map.
If I may, excuse me, I just want to echo the sentiments from Commissioner Sand. I do really like the access to Boeing, and I also think it's very important to also have access to Payne Field. I know we're one of the few growing metropolitan regions that don't have multiple airports, and if anyone's tried to fly out of SeaTac recently, it's a headache. So having, and I know we recently, there was recent at the county level approval for having more flights come into Payne Field, so a station at Payne, I think, is something that we should lobby for. And if I may ask one question, just for clarification, what were some of the concerns from the business community on Evergreen Way for having the light rail run along Evergreen Way?
About three that come to mind. One is that Evergreen Way is already very congested at peak periods, and that putting a light rail line somewhere within that right-of-way would eliminate either a travel lane or a turn lane. Turning movements was a big deal for a lot of the businesses, especially left turn movements in and out of their businesses, and so having a light rail line running down the center or down either side of Evergreen Way was something that they felt would be very disruptive to business access. And the third comment that we heard quite a bit is that bus rapid transit is working very well, and we have a high degree of not only BRT, but also local transit service to where you can catch a bus probably every few minutes just about at any of the either Swift stations or the Everett Transit stations that are stops that exist on Evergreen Way. So it would probably be better located in another corridor that provided service to underserved areas.
Thank you.
There are no more comments or questions. That's really just an informational item for you tonight, not any action required or requested.
Alan, many thanks to you and to Paul Roberts. I know Paul spent a tremendous amount of time working on this issue and promoting the interests of the city, and we're really fortunate to have you and Paul.
And there's a lot of other
so hard.
A lot of other folks, and I'll just throw a few names out there. Ryan Sass, Tom Hinkson, Pat McLean have been working on this along with several others of us.
Yeah, kudos to all of you.
And last but not least, the mayor.
Alan, how is the, where we're outside of the area, I mean, some of that out in Payne Field area is not ever proper.
Mm-hmm.
How is the Snohomish County, are they in sync with what the city's trying to do, and or is Mukilteo in sync with, you know, having it stretch out?
Yeah, I would say that for Snohomish County, they're very engaged, and we talk with them from time to time. I know that we have a board member. They have a board member on the Sound Transit Board of Directors, and so they're putting a lot of effort into this, too. They are taking the lead for especially the planning around their two urban centers, the 164th and 128th I-5 interchanges, and so they're desirous to have good service to both of those designated growth centers, and they're showing some plans that would improve access around those very congested corridors there with some additional access over I-5 that is not for general purpose traffic but for bus access, pedestrian access, and getting to the light rail stations. They're also looking at, I think the county's priority is to figure out how to move this huge population east of I-5 to get them out of cars and into transit, and so they want to keep access as close to that population that really isn't served as well as areas west of I-5 for transit and serve in particularly those two locations. Mukilteo, I'm not sure how engaged Mukilteo or some of the other cities that are really off the light rail line have been. I know that Sound Transit has done outreach to them, but I haven't been involved in to know their issues.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address the commission on this topic tonight? Seeing none, it looks like we'll move on to item three, which is the commission bylaws.
All right, David Stahlheim again, and from all this exciting long-range planning visioning things to the rules of business for the Planning Commission. So one of the wonderful things about the internet is that you can find pictures of your new alternates. So it's like you Google and you look for images. And so what year is that, Alex?
That is me and my Bank of America intern, Mr. Spencer Knapp, from earlier this summer. Great guy. I mean, uh-huh. If you ever get a chance to get him as an intern, take him on. He's fantastic.
All right. Fantastic. And I'm not sure where that picture came from, Megan, but I saw some pictures, and they're nice ones, and people smiling, so I grabbed it. So we'll ask her when she's back here next time. So, of course, we talked at the last meeting. Now you have two alternates, and so we have this issue about having two alternates, and there's some things. So I wrote you a memo, just kind of identify some of the issues real quickly, and then turn it over to you guys for discussion. So first off, the city code actually recognizes that there can be two alternates, which was a little bit of a surprise, I think, for staff, although apparently in the past it did, it could have been in place in the past. But it does say that the alternates shall serve in the absence of members when so asked by the commission chairperson. So the city code actually provides that authority to the chairperson. So the chairperson does have that authority within the code, which is then actually also within the bylaws that you have. And the bylaws, one of the things that is the disconnect is that the bylaws only talk about one alternate rather than two, whereas the city code does allow for the two alternates appointed by the mayor, confirmed by the council. The bylaws only recognize one. And again, in here it says alternate having discussion, but voting member in the absence when asked by the chairperson. So the bylaws reflect what the city code actually says with respect to that. So for you guys to amend the bylaws, it does take five votes of the regular members. And so as we talk about this, it does take that. Doesn't anything else about advance notice? There's sometimes you see things have to be in writing for 30 days, things like that. You don't have any of those rules in place, but we don't have any amendments prepared for you to act. So this. Anticipated this is more kind of a direction meeting tonight. So the first one I think is fairly easily just to kind of clean up is to kind of deal with the number of members. And so one of the things I just drafted up here is just really is to mimic the city code. And so the Planning Commission shall consist of seven members. It talks about how it's appointed and then with the two members serving as alternates. So that way the language is exactly out of city code. And it deals with the conflict really in your bylaws that only looks at one member. So now it gets to the more difficult things. So how do you want to do voting options? And so looking and thinking about this a little bit, kind of came up with four options. Option A is the chair decides. Option B, looking at a rotating vote. Option C, looking at agenda items. And then option D, having those members that are absent choose their alternate. So option A, again, the chair decides. So no matter what, the chair actually does have the authority in city code. Part of the idea of a bylaw amendment is for the rest of the members to kind of direct the chair how he's going to exercise that authority. But if the chair doesn't perhaps want to do it, the chair, in theory, could say, even though you've directed me to do that, maybe not to do that. If you want to change city code, we could go and take that to the council as a code amendment as well. That could be an option. We heard at the last meeting, I think the current chair doesn't like this option. So
I'm getting more open to it as I've looked at the other options.
There you go. And I think the thing, too, about that, too, is that it is if and who gets a vote. It's even if you only had five members here, there is actually discretion to say whether or not anyone votes. There's not anything that's automatic that the alternates vote. So again, it's kind of discretionary there. So option B came up with is rotating votes. So again, in those situations, and tonight we don't have that, but when there's six regular members and two alternates, that the alternates simply rotate their votes. My suggestion is to look at substantive items, so the agenda items, and use as an example the last meeting where you had community center discussion, and you had a lot of interim motions. So rather than rotating things between on that one item, is that one member would be assigned community centers and the other would have been adaptive reuse. And so that commission member is assigned throughout that. And so that's how that could have happened with a rotating vote schedule. Option C that came up was assigned items. So sometimes the agenda item may not finish. You may have motions, you're working on business, you don't finish your business in that evening and it's gonna transfer to the next meeting. And so taking, all of a sudden having the alternate, a different alternate vote could be problematic a little bit. And so as taking that amendments into the next meeting, and there could be a blend of B and C within these. And then, of course, doing the internet search, I kind of looked at, alternate voting alternates and came up with this whole thing about, designated alternates. And it really was this whole concept of having, for example, Alan's on a staff committee of the Puget Sound Regional Council, and he's designated me as an alternate. And so if Alan's not available, I go as his alternate type of thing. So I started going, well, how about the member that's not there choose their alternate? I'm not sure that it's a great idea, but I think it's an idea to throw out there for that. So those are the options that I came up with, and so let you guys now talk about that.
Thank you, David. Well, yes.
Can I throw another option up there? And it's a variation of B. And that is, it would be a rotating assignment by meeting, not necessarily agenda item. So it's a little bit of a variation. And I know when I did my research on this a little bit, it's wonderful what you can find on the internet. Some communities actually draw cards or will flip a coin between the two alternates, decide who's got what and when they might be assigned, or maybe they could be assigned the first meeting of the month, the other is the second meeting, the first meeting, the second meeting, something like that. So there's all kinds of variations and options out there. But my concern about having it for a particular agenda item, it seems to me that's kind of complicated and it's hard to track, and all of us sometimes are not here, but yet we have the ability to come up to speed by looking at the video that's online or look at the materials. And so, I mean, everything was available to kind of refresh yourself or at least understand the conversation. So I would be more along the lines of having an assignment by meeting as opposed to agenda item.
Well, I guess along those lines too, you have their alternates 8 and then 9, so you have an even and an odd, so you have a meeting 1 and meeting 2 of the month, you could do it even odd or something like that as well. So I guess that's kind of in line with what we're thinking on the rotating.
Yeah, I would prefer that they could all participate at all the meetings. It's just a question of who gets to vote.
Right.
I wonder about that. I mean, if 5 regular commissioners show up and 2 alternates show up, there are 7 votes available, right? So
correct.
In that instance, 2 alternates could have a voting participation.
Correct.
Now, my only concern, and I'm certainly not casting any aspersions on the chair, but I would be concerned that everything is absolutely 100% fair in every instance, and that everybody has an equal shot, and that first of all, leaving it up to a chair, I would actually, if it were up to you, I'd be comfortable that you would always be fair about it, and if it were you, flip a coin, draw straws, go eeny, meeny, miny, moe, or or something to that effect, you'd probably always be fair about who gets to sit in on that, you know, or vote on any motion. But I would want to be absolutely certain that it is absolutely 100% fair and that there is no preferential treatment whatsoever under any circumstances. And that's why, you know, considering the idea of participating based on a certain agenda item makes me a little uncomfortable because it leaves it open to a little bit of manipulation. Although these sound like very, what I'm describing might sound very treacherous, but I don't want to imply anything. I just want to be sure that everything is on the up and up and it's absolutely fair in every case. And that, you know, if, you know, there have been times when only, what, four commissioners showed up and it would have been nice to have two. And then there's the issue of odd versus even. We have seven regular commissioners so that we will not have a tie vote, you know, if there's an odd number of votes. So if we ended up with, you know, six regular commissioners and two alternates, one of them might not get to vote because it would, you know, of course, I've never seen an absolute split down the middle tie, you know, but, you know, there is that potentiality. So those are the concerns that I have.
I say keep it simple and let the chair decide. I think the chair has good discretion, and the chair's probably going to be the one that attends most often. So not that you want to hear that, but I just think, you know, in terms of bookkeeping and simplicity, I think it's going to be easier just to have the chair decide. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I guess if, you know, you're having those two alternates and I think it would be prudent if you have something that you're voting on and you have a situation, I mean, just to ask the alternates to disclose if they have any conflict of interest or anything like that on the particular topics of the evening. And then that could, you know, obviously sway, you know, if they do, then obviously we want the other alternate to be the voting member for the evening. So that seems pretty simple. And just as I described before, as far as picking, if it were me, if it was the first meeting of the month, I'd take the odd person. If it was the second meeting of the month, I'd take the even person. So that's how I would approach it as chair right now. So it wouldn't take anything as far as amending the municipal code or anything like that. It would just be amending to make sure that we have the two alternates on there. So I'm comfortable with that version. It seems like the most simple version and the fair and equitable. So
it's predictable as well.
Correct.
And if Kathy does this little survey before the meeting, you would know if we need to have one alternate or two alternates voting. I think the other complication though is where does the second alternate sit?
We'll squeeze a chair up there.
Yeah, maybe that's the way you do it. I don't know.
We can get close for someone else.
And you bring up a good point as far as just communication by letting Kathy know who's, you know, if you're not going to be able to attend. Obviously, things come up, but, you know, the sooner you can let her know if you're not going to be in attendance, I think it just helps things, you know, obviously setting up this area too, but, you know, just even identifying if we're going to have that situation in the future. So, Commissioner Zielinski.
The situation only arises when we have one regular member missing and both alternates show up, right? So
correct.
Presumably that's not going to happen all that often. In the instance where the one missing person is the chair, presumably the authority would then fall to the vice chair.
Right.
So I'm comfortable with that approach too.
Want to entertain a move?
So you were just looking for more of a discussion thing. We didn't have any real alternatives other than what was proposed by David.
In theory, if you don't want to change anything other than this, I mean, in theory, we've drafted the language for you.
So the movement would be to adopt the red highlights on options for amendment number one. And by doing that, then Commissioner Holland would be responsible for appointing who was going to be the...
Yeah, he would, and I guess he would communicate that to Kathy, and of course any of these options that we've already laid out are all at his discretion to use, and the other options we just talked about too. So he could use any of those methods, but it would be there.
But I had one thing.
Yeah.
David, you did a really good job going through and putting this all together for us. This was a very minor issue that we discussed 2 years ago, and it's one that we were assured that probably we would never have again because of the issues that Alan pointed out. So I think this change is a good change because it's a minor amendment that deals with the issue, but we may not be dealing with this for, you know, it may not be that we have someone appointed next year right away. I mean, there have been years where we go 24 months and we don't have any alternates. And so I think this is a good minor amendment that deals with the issue in the short term, but doesn't make a huge substantive change to our bylaws at the same time.
I guess we're looking for a little direction. I guess since they're your bylaws and there's not a requirement under any city charter ordinance for you to hold a public hearing, you could make the decision tonight if you so chose to amend your bylaw in, as it is drafted and you've discussed, or if you wanted to put it out there for public comment and perhaps make a decision at a future meeting, you could do that too.
Yes.
Is it possible to insert someplace the fact that the chair will select the alternate for participation on a rotating basis to provide equal opportunity to both alternates? So that would get kind of at your concern that it's...
It's up to the commission. It's your bylaws. You can do pretty much what you want with them.
Just one comment on that. So you get into a situation where you're doing the alternating thing. It could be 6-8 months between the opportunity where one commissioner has.
That's true.
Are you going to have to go back and remember who was the last person that actually got to vote on something because it's been so long? So I don't want to get us into a situation where you're doing something incorrectly when you don't even realize it though either. So.
So we'll just wait till you mess up, and then we'll
take
you to task.
Yeah. Okay.
So how about I make a movement to basically change the bylaws to add the amendments on number one, the number of alternates, that the Planning Commission shall consist of 7 members appointed by the mayor with the approval of council. Additionally, 2 individuals may be appointed by the, is this what we need to be adopting to change the bylaws? Okay. Additionally, 2 individuals may be appointed by the mayor with the approval of council to serve in the capacity of alternates. So we have 2 alternates.
I'll second that motion.
Yes.
Commissioner Zielinski?
Yes.
Commissioner Beck?
Yes.
Commissioner Jordison?
Yes.
Commissioner Sand?
Yes.
Commissioner Adams?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So if that's what we're voting on, where does it say, and maybe I'm just missing, where does it say that the chair has the power to select?
It's already in the municipal code, and it's also currently in our bylaws.
It's understood. And we're just saying that we now have 2 alternates.
So you're not even addressing that issue. All you're doing is addressing it to make sure that the bylaws are consistent with the current municipal code.
If that's the case, then you just have to change 7 members plus 1 alternate to plus 2 alternates.
Right. Just how David has presented it up there is the amendment number 1 is recommended. So it doesn't address the issue that we were discussing earlier about, you know, that the chairperson has the authority to select the voting member of the alternates. All it does is amend the bylaws to be consistent with the current code.
That's still there as part when asked by the chairperson to participate.
Yeah, and for further clarification, if you look at the memo, the whole section 2 of Article 4 meetings is there in your memo. So you're actually just amending that first sentence out of those bylaws. So all the rest will continue in those bylaws. And that talks about the chair appointing and the participation of the alternate. So none of that changes. We're just talking about the composition. That's the only thing that changes.
Perfect. Thank you. I just want to make sure I understood that. My vote is yes.
Where you were.
More proven.
Commissioner Tisdale?
Yes.
Chair Holland?
Yes. Any other business tonight for us, Alan?
Yes, I'll a couple of real quick things here, too. When I was reviewing the minutes of the last meeting, I mentioned something about the college sub-area plan and maybe talking about it at this meeting. Well, wanted to mention that not only did we have a full enough agenda without talking about that, we are, as was mentioned earlier in the discussion about the Metropolitan Center, delayed a little bit. We are going to be applying for a grant as co-applicants with the Everett Housing Authority for the area up around the Baker Heights neighborhood, which will also encompass, for their purposes, a portion of the Everett Community College campus on the east side, actually, where the Washington State University is being built. If we're successful in obtaining that grant, then it's like a $500,000 grant from HUD that would bring a lot of resources to conduct a neighborhood transformation process for that neighborhood. And the Housing Authority does have some plans, as you may have seen in the press, for demolishing the Baker Heights housing up there. And so this is something that they would be applying for independent of the need to demolish the housing. But the whether they get the grant or not, they've committed to planning with us, and we're looking to kind of combine our planning goals around the college and their growth needs and impacts on the neighborhood, along with their opportunity to secure a grant, perhaps, for this neighborhood transformation. We thought that rather than doing two parallel planning processes and trying to explain the difference between the two, that we would work with the Housing Authority and combine them into a single planning process. We're still going to have to do a lot of work to figure out how to not let the different motives behind their planning and our planning get lost or separated or confused. But because of this opportunity for the grant, we are delaying a little bit. And at some point in the future, I'll bring something back to you, probably before we even know the fate of that grant, but something that would talk about the planning process that we're as we work to try to define that more accurately with the Housing Authority.
So. Yes.
Regarding the Housing Authority's property, Baker Heights, if they were to take away that housing, are they obligated or expected to replace with the same number of units someplace else, or are they just like a property owner that could just take it out and the city would lose that kind of housing capacity? Yeah.
Under the HUD rules, they're not obligated to replace an equal number of units, but they are required to provide vouchers to each of the tenants within Baker Heights for relocation to another housing unit of their choice within the area.
Yeah, the complication there is it's Section 8, I think, and then the owner, the rental would have to agree to accept those vouchers. So.
And I don't know the details of that. David knows a bit more about housing and how HUD works than I do, but I think that we can bring more information back to you to a future meeting to talk about that. But the mayor and I met with Ashley Lomars Johnson, the executive director of the Housing Authority, last week, and at the meeting that public meeting, the week ahead of that, he explained all of that to the residents who attended that meeting. There were probably about 200 people that showed up to that meeting, and but they would be providing replacement vouchers and relocating those tenants over probably about a three-year time frame. So it's not something where people would be having to make a decision to move right away.
Quick question. How are you approaching SEPA with all these planning efforts in terms of, I mean, so for the Metropolitan Center plan, that's going to be a programmatic SEPA, isn't it?
We'll be doing either a detailed checklist or an EIS or perhaps a supplemental EIS. But we haven't figured out whether or not we're going to do the planned action type of programmatic EIS where we would expand the planned action to the larger area. That would be something that under state law requires probably a lot more work than is really justified to do an environmental impact statement, given the nature of the urban environment. For the downtown plan, we did a planned action that matched the boundary of the B3 zone exactly. Right. And that planned action, we spent about $200,000 doing an EIS, and we came up, the only mitigation that we identified was existing codes. And so it was a lot of work for not a lot of outcome that you might have in some an environment that's a lot more, you know, perhaps greenfield type of environment. But yeah, we haven't determined what the nature of the SEPA will look like when we get done with the metro plan.
Has there been any evidence that because there was a programmatic SEPA or a planned action in place that it might have made those properties more attractive in terms of redevelopment, or did it really make a difference?
Well, it has made a difference to a few of the developments that have occurred since that time, but there haven't been that many.
Right.
It's not like Southwest Everett where we've got a almost 20-year track record and we've authorized over 5 million square feet of development through that expedited SEPA process. This is a smaller area and a much shorter time frame that it's been in place. And one other thing we will probably be bringing back to you in the very near future, request to initiate some code amendments around the housing issues that have come out of the Community Streets Initiative, low barrier housing or supportive housing, to address some things that our code does not currently address. So those are some things that when we get a little bit more detail as to what the full extent of those are, we'll bring back to you at a future meeting and ask you to initiate that process.
So how would a low barrier housing proposal be processed now? Is it outright permitted in some zones, or is it through a special use permit process?
There's not a good fit in our code for that. Low barrier housing would fall under one of two things in our code, either multifamily housing, and our code doesn't work really well for using that to address low barrier housing because it has parking requirements that are really not necessary for the low barrier housing, and perhaps a few other development standards. But in that case, it would just be reviewed or allowed wherever multifamily housing would be allowed. We have another category in our land use code called temporary shelter housing. Low barrier housing tends not to be temporary. People can live there for years. And so that one isn't really a good fit either. So a little bit of code work and perhaps some tweaking around some restrictions that we have in certain geographic areas that might be necessary too. But we'll get a more detailed list together and bring that forward at some point in the future.
Any other questions to staff?
Next meeting.
Just one other thing, I just do want to make a note. Because I didn't prepare the bylaws as amendments, I was just reading that whole section, and so just as a Scrivener writing issue is that it does refer to alternate and the single in some of the rest of the sentences, so as it comes back to you, it will be in the plural. So I assume that's all right with the commission, that we pluralize the alternate throughout that section, so.
Yes, please.
We don't have any immediate business for you for probably the next meeting, I don't think. So at this point, I think that I can't think of a reason why we have to meet in 2 weeks. So we could put that off till the first Tuesday in March, and by then I'm sure we'll have some more business for you.
Great. Anything else? Thank you. We're adjourned.